Reaction is demonstrated here. Okay, let's take a look at the preparation of a halogen haloalkane, also known as an alkyl halide, or indeed haloalkane, from the corresponding alcohol. We could look at the preparation of bromoethane from ethanol, a conversion of a primary alcohol to the corresponding alkyl halide. We're using 2-methylpropan-2-ol, and we're going to introduce the halogen Cl. We're going to convert it to the corresponding chloral halogen haloalkane. Here you see the reactants that we need. We have the alcohol here, also known as tertiary butyl alcohol, or 2-methylpropan-2-ol. The other reactant is concentrated hydrochloric acid, so these are the two reactants. The remaining chemicals are used as part of the purification procedure, and here I've got aqueous sodium hydrogen carbonate, which will be used to remove the excess hydrochloric acid. I've also got here anhydrous sodium sulfate, which will be used to dry the product to remove the water. It'll be shaken with that for about 5 minutes. And then once I've got to that stage, I will carry out simple distillation and collect the fraction over a particular range of temperature. And this is my simple distillation setup with my pear-shaped reaction flask, Liebig condenser, and over here later we will collect then in a weighed pear-shaped flask, we'll collect the product over that particular temperature range. Now the reaction is carried out in a separating funnel. We're ready now to carry out the reaction itself, and it'll be carried out in the tap funnel or separating funnel you see on the right. Okay, the first instruction then in this practical is to, I'm going to put in my alcohol, going to measure it using a measuring cylinder. This is my alcohol here, 2-methylpropan-2-ol, which perhaps you can see is also known as tertiary butyl alcohol. I have a 10 cubic centimeter measuring cylinder here. This is my alcohol out in a beaker. It's a colorless clear liquid. This alcohol actually tends to solidify at room temperature, so I did place the bottle in some warm water for a little while. So I pour out into that about 9 cubic centimeters. I say about because we're actually going to measure its mass accurately. So there's about 9 cubic centimeters measured out. I'm going to put it on a top pan balance now. I'm just getting it to 0.0. And now it's reading 0.00. And we record that mass. That's 15.06 grams. I'm now going to transfer most of that to the separating funnel. And then I'm going to record the mass of the measuring cylinder once again. And that's 7.99. So we subtract 7.99 from 15.06. And that comes out as 7.07 grams. So I have transferred 7.07 grams of my alcohol into the separating funnel here. Here I have the other reactant, concentrated hydrochloric acid. I have measured out 20 cubic centimeters using a measuring cylinder. The concentrated hydrochloric acid will be in excess, so the precise volume is not necessary so long as we know it's clearly in excess. What I'm now going to do is add this slowly, about 3 cubic centimeters at a time, with shaking. So in goes the first 3 cubic centimeters very slowly. Let it run down the edge if we can, run down the inside. I now place a stopper on this. Here I've added my first 3 cubic centimetres of concentrated hydrochloric acid to the alcohol, and what I do is I hold the stopper here and I invert this a few times just to make sure that the two reactants are mixing and reacting. There will be some acid, of course, on the stopper here, so I'm setting it down on a heatproof mat to protect the bench. And I'm ready then to add the next 3 cubic centimeters, approximately. If I tilt it on its side, I can let it run down the edge slowly. And I repeat this process, turn it on its side. There's no significant pressure really building up here, but one releases the stopper. When one releases the stopper, if there was any pressure built up, then it would be released. Even an exothermic reaction occurring in there would cause the air above to warm up and expand, which in itself would cause a buildup of pressure. And of course, if any gases were produced, that would cause a buildup of pressure. I have about half of it added at this stage, and remember the reactions occurring here, nucleophilic substitution. The OH group in the alcohol is being replaced by the Cl of the concentrated hydrochloric acid. I'm wearing gloves because of the corrosive nature of the concentrated acid, of course. I'm now adding the last little bit of concentrated hydrochloric acid, inverting it, make sure the reactants fully mix and react. Now I'm going to let this sit in the fume cupboard for about 20 minutes to give the reaction plenty of time to go as far to the right as possible. Here we are then after about 25 minutes, and you can see perhaps here that we have two layers. We have the upper organic layer and the lower aqueous layer here. I'm going to remove the stopper and run off the lower aqueous layer and discard that. Okay, so I'm now going to run off the lower aqueous layer and discard it. Take the stopper off. This stage I can just see the interface between the two layers here, I'm going to run it out nice and slowly. Interface is now just here and here, getting close down to here now, and add it very, very slowly at this stage. It can be difficult to see the separation, and there it goes. We now have this lower aqueous layer in the beaker. Before I throw it down the sink, I'd like to make sure that that indeed is the aqueous layer. The best thing to do is to simply take a wash bottle and add some water to see if in fact it's fully miscible with this lower supposedly aqueous layer. So I've collected the lower layer, the aqueous layer, and just to make absolutely sure that it is the aqueous layer, I'm using a wash bottle to add water. And of course, if I'm right, that should be fully miscible. And you would do this clearly before emptying it down the sink. Now at this stage, I'll have got rid of any or most of the polar materials that would be present. I've got rid of a good deal of the excess hydrochloric acid. Okay, let's set about purifying the product now. Present with the halogen alkane will be some of the hydrochloric acid that was present in excess. A lot of the hydrochloric acid will have been removed, of course, with the lower aqueous layer. Here I've got sodium hydrogen carbonate solution, and I'm going to add this 2 cubic centimeters at a time and shake it, because this of course is an aqueous polar solution and my product is non-polar. And remember that while all that I've done is replace the OH and the alcohol Cl, that this compound, unlike the alcohol, cannot hydrogen bond. So while the alcohol will be miscible with water, the halogen alkane will not. So here we've got, I'm going to add a few cubic centimeters, and you may notice some effervescence here if we come in a little bit closer. Let's see if we see some bubbling. And what I do then is to put the stopper on and shake this. So we'll put the stopper on there. And you can just shake it up and down or turn it upside down a few times. Now any CO2 that is produced obviously has to be released, and we can remove the stopper. And you may have heard some of the gas being released there. We continue, we add another couple of cubic centimeters of the sodium hydrogen carbonate. Still a little bit of effervescence there, so we continue doing this. Because the aqueous layer is immiscible with the product, one being polar and the other non-polar, we are required to shake them, of course. What you can also do is hold it upside down and release the stopcock here. You may hear it hiss if there's any gas. Let's see if there is. A little bit there. Still. Still a little bit there. So add a little bit more of the aqueous sodium hydrogen carbonate. And shake it like this as well. Forcing the non-polar layer through the polar layer. Let's open the stopcock, see if we get any gas coming out. A little bit there. Still just a little bit there, I think. Just to make absolutely sure we've got rid of all the acid. What we're doing here, of course, is carrying out a reaction between an acid and a metal, hydrogen carbonate, forming a salt, CO2 and water. Let's test now and see if there's any gas. Still a little bit there. Okay, I think at this stage we've got rid of the acid impurity now. Think about this as I leave it to begin to settle once again. Now it seems to have completely separated here. You may be able to see the upper layer has indeed separated there. And I'm going to run off the lower layer, which should be the aqueous layer. Again, as I get close to the interface between the layers, I'll slow it up. Almost there, a little bit more, and that's it. One may lose a little bit of the product at that stage. This is the upper layer. So this is the product with the any hydrochloric acid that might have been mixed with it removed using aqueous sodium hydrogen carbonate. This is the lower aqueous layer in a beaker, just to be absolutely sure that it is indeed the aqueous layer. I'm adding some deionized water just to make absolutely sure we don't get two layers. And there now I'm convinced that I've got it correct, that the aqueous layer was the lower layer, and that I have indeed retained here in the separating funnel the organic product. Okay, here I've got the upper layer, my organic product. I've got a conical flask here, 100 cubic centimeter conical flask. I'm going to run all of that now into the flask. Just make sure we've got all of that in there. And I'm going to add now just a few spatula measures of the anhydrous sodium sulfate to dry the organic product. So just two or three spatula measures of anhydrous sodium sulfate. We'll put on a rubber bung. And I'm now going to shake this occasionally for the next 10 minutes. And this is drying the water, which will have been caught up, that has been caught up then with the organic product. Okay, I have shaken this frequently over a period of about 10 minutes, in fact, with the anhydrous sodium sulfate, and this should have removed the water. What I'm now going to do is carefully decant the liquid, my organic product, off from this. But I must ensure that no solid is transferred over. I'm trying to get all it in, but no solid passing over. And the solid is very damp and it sticks behind. Okay, I'm reasonably happy that I've transferred all of that over. A little bit, obviously, of my product is left behind there because the solid is in fact damp. And if you're asked about why the yield is lower than 100%, there are many reasons, including this one, the fact that some of the product unfortunately is left behind there at that stage. I'm going to weigh this empty flask that's going to collect our distillate. So I've just put a beaker on here to support that. First of all, make sure it's reading, hit the tear button to have it, the balance is reading 0.00. And those two together weigh 88.53 grams. We're ready to begin to distill it now using simple distillation. You can see the setup we've got here. We have the halogen alkane here in a pear-shaped flask placed about a couple of centimeters above the gauze. The Bunsen will heat the gauze will heat the air coming in, and the flask will be heated by a stream of warm convection current. We have a thermometer placed in here, which as well as sealing the top here so that the vapour will have to enter the condenser. It'll be used to record the temperature. Anything that comes off before 47 degrees C will be discarded. We'll collect only what distills off between 47 and 53. Anything coming off after 53 will not be collected. Now, for that reason, I'm going to have a beaker here which will collect anything that distills off before 47 degrees centigrade. When we get to 47 degrees centigrade, then I'll replace that beaker with the pear-shaped flask. and collect the fraction over that narrow temperature range. Okay, so we're ready to start. I have a stream of cold water going through the condenser. It's coming in at the bottom and going out at the top here. Ready to light the Bunsen. Remember, we're collecting anything between 47 and 53. At this stage, nothing has distilled over, and the temperature is around 30 degrees C. Okay, a small amount did come over as the temperature rose to 47. I'm now going to change the over to the pear-shaped flask. And here you can see the fraction that's distilling over between the temperature range required, 47 to 53 degrees C. Temperature at the moment is reading 48.5. You can see the temperature at the moment. Most of it is distilled over at this stage. I've stopped heating now, and we'll wait for any vapour that has come off to condense and be collected in this pear-shaped receiving flask. Just tap it gently with that last drop. And that's the distillation finished. We've collected our product here over a relatively narrow temperature range between 47 and 53 degrees C. Here you see what I have collected in the pear-shaped flask, and this is the amount that I'm going to discard. This came off before the temperature reached 47 degrees C. So here's my product, and you'll recall how I weighed this, setting it inside the speaker. So we'll go back again now and weigh it. The balance is reading 0.00, and you should record now the reading, and that's 90.37. It had been 91.25. Do you recall the test for an aldehyde? We take feelings 1 and feelings 2. There's feelings 1 on the left hand side, a copper sulfate solution, and on the right feelings 2 is a hydroxide solution. What we do to make up feelings solution for this test is we take some of the blue copper sulfate solution, feelings 1, and then we add dropwise feelings 2. We get a precipitate with a few drops. Do you see there? And we continue until the precipitate just redissolves and we get a dark blue solution. And there we go. So we've made up feeling solution freshly there. I'm going to take then our product, add the feeling solution to that, and I'm going to put it in a warm water bath, as you can see here. And let's see what happens. And there you see it goes through green. You may just be able to make out the green colour there perhaps, but it also then goes from green through to a brick red colour. And that's a positive test for an aldehyde using feeling solution.